Another promising sign in the fight against COVID-19. US drugmaker Moderna says its vaccine is nearly 95% effective. Is there an end in sight to the global pandemic? This is Inside Story. Hello, welcome to the programme. I'm Bernard Smith. A second potential COVID-19 vaccine is raising hopes around the world. US drugmaker Moderna says trials have shown its vaccine is nearly 95% effective against the virus. Last week, Pfizer and Biontech announced similar results, but many challenges remain. Regulators in the United States and elsewhere still have to approve the new vaccines. Then there's the question of supply and demand, as well as how to distribute billions of doses globally. And some countries may not even be able to afford them. Moderna's president spoke about the work that lies ahead.
It's a really important milestone in the fight against the pandemic because it demonstrates that our vaccine, mRNA-1273, is able to prevent COVID-19 disease, including severe disease in people who've received it. It's really just a milestone, though. We have a lot of work ahead of us. Knowing the vaccine is going to be effective is great news, but we still need to complete the regulatory process, which involves completing the study and generating more data, even some follow-up and safety data. And then, of course, we need to get busy manufacturing.
With all this encouraging news about vaccines, there's a risk some may let their guard down when it comes to COVID-19 measures. The World Health Organization is encouraging people to keep wearing masks and socially distance.
This is not the time for complacency. While we continue to receive encouraging news about COVID-19 vaccines and remain cautiously optimistic about the potential for new tools to start to arrive in the coming months, right now, we're extremely concerned by the surge in cases we're seeing in some countries, particularly in Europe and the Americas.
Now let's hear from the volunteers who took part in Moderna's vaccine trial and how they feel about their experience.
As a phase one trial participant, the purpose of that trial, of the initial trial, is to test safety in humans, and I happened to be the first human to be injected with this trial vaccine, and it went great, and I feel good.
I was just kind of throwing my name in the hat to see if this was something I could do to help out mankind. It's been kind of a whirlwind to see how badly this has spiraled out of control in countries that aren't locking down and taking the precautions seriously. So it's definitely something that could help the world a lot if we can get this vaccine out sooner.
Pfizer says it will start a pilot delivery scheme for its experimental vaccine. It will test distribution methods across four states in the US: Rhode Island, Texas, New Mexico, and Tennessee. But the company says this doesn't mean those states will have preferential access to the vaccine if approved. Preliminary results show Pfizer's inoculation to be more than 90% effective, but it must be shipped and stored at minus 70 degrees Celsius. Let's bring in our guests. In Grindelwald in Switzerland is Dr. Annelise Wilder-Smith, Professor of Emerging Infectious Diseases at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and she's also a consultant to the Initiative of Vaccine Research at the World Health Organization. In Kenitra in Morocco is Azeddine Ibrahimi. He's Director of the Biotechnology Lab at Rabat Medical and Pharmacy School and Mohammed V University. And joining us from London is Oksana Pizik. She's lead at University College London's Global Citizenship Programme on outbreaks of infectious diseases. Welcome to you all. Annelise, first of all, if I can start with you. Moderna's figures are based on the first 95 participants who fell sick. 90 of them had received the placebo. So is that enough for people to confidently say the vaccine is 94.5% effective?
So these are the results of the interim analysis based on a smaller event size. So the company has announced it will continue its trial until they have reached the pre-specified number of events. when they then will do the final analysis. Once you have the final analysis, you can really look at the entire, you know, number of participants and look at, and have a better look at efficacy and safety, also in subpopulations like the older or those with comorbidities. But indeed, the interim analysis do look promising.
Azeddine, you think it looks promising?
Well, I think so. I think basically because the vaccines, a lot of them actually went through the phase one. That was the toxicity, the phase two, and it shows some efficacy that was really good. And now we have the first result. It's showing good results, actually. I think between Pfizer and between Moderna, the results are very good. 90% of the population is actually having the antibodies against the COVID-2. And they think what's going to happen, I agree with my colleague, actually. We want to see the numbers, increase the numbers to have a clear idea. And I think the subpopulation is something very good. I just want to remind everybody and remind the public that when the best thing, the best vaccine that we are looking for actually is the vaccine that will have no adverse drug reaction or adverse immunization reaction. And the second thing will be that something that will be personalized. Since we don't have that yet, it will be some adverse reaction, and we can talk about that. But I think finally, the results that are here are very encouraging, and I think more companies are coming with the results soon.
And Azeddine, I also wanted to ask you, Pfizer and Moderna use this mRNA method. What, just for the layman, what is this? Why is it so significant?
Well, I think it's great news. I think I'm more excited about the fact that these two companies use this technology. There is another company in Germany using the same technology because it opens up this era of genetic therapy, genomic therapy and things like that, and reminded me and remind everybody that this year the Nobel Prize was about CRISPR-Cas9. That is a technology actually that aims to correct all the genetic defects. So what happened is instead of having an antigen introduced to the body, like having inactivated virus or through adenovirus, what we do actually is bring in the RNA messenger, that is the genetic code kind of a couple of proteins, and bring it into the cells and be able actually to create into the cell, the human cells, to have the antigen and have the antibodies actually produced, and that people can see in a few years, maybe this technology can be used to produce protein as drugs and maybe correct some genetic defects.
Oksana, we're talking about billions of doses of vaccine that will be needed ultimately. What are the main components needed to make the vaccine? And practically, are there going to be short supplies of things like reagents and vials and syringes? What are those challenges?
Well, you've highlighted perfectly some of the logistical challenges that some countries will face from a manufacturing perspective. Even the basics, forget what goes into the vaccine itself, including the reagents, the active pharmaceutical ingredient, the proteins, etc. What we will be looking at is just even the supply of syringes. And many countries in the world already, since the beginning of the pandemic, have faced shortages of essential supplies. So if we go back to March, we remember how hard it was to trace PPE, that diagnostic tests, et cetera. And that also opened a big gap in the market for not only substandard, but falsified products to enter. And this will, of course, be an issue once a vaccine does become available to the wider population due to the sheer demand. There has never been a mass vaccination campaign at this scale and within this time frame before. So we cannot underestimate how difficult that is going to be. But the WHO, through the COVAX facility, is working with 186 countries and economies to be able to really be focused on manufacturing as well as purchasing doses in order for this distribution to be a bit more equitable, because as we know, this is a global pandemic. We can't just focus on a vaccine reaching one part of the world, but not the other, because it will continue to cross borders and reinfect, and ultimately it will prolong the pandemic. So the larger challenge after it clears the final safety hurdles will also be around ensuring that these fragile pharmaceutical supply chains in some parts of the world are strengthened, which will mean we'll also have to increase regulatory capacity.
Okay. And Annelise, what percentage of the population are we going to have to vaccinate for this to work? And can I ask, does it, if the vaccine is more effective, can you get away with vaccinating less people? Does it work like that or not? Please correct me if I'm wrong.
So indeed, there's a lot of thinking going around how best to use this vaccine at a time when we know that initially we have limited vaccine supply. And we know that most of the deaths or and the severe disease and hospitalization ICU care is needed for the older age group. So the initial priority then would be first to administer the vaccine to those at highest risk of severe disease outcomes, but also acknowledging that healthcare workers are putting their lives at stake for the sake of society, that we will also, to honor their service, we would also offer it to the health workers very early on, even when we have limited vaccine supply, as they deserve protection.
Okay. And Azeddine, how quickly has the development of these vaccines been compared to the time it takes normally for other vaccines?
Well, I think that's a good question, but I would like to just to come back to the sure. previous question, just to say that we can have an impact on the clinical part if we can actually get to 20% of the population that needs actually to get protected. Since we know that the virus actually for 80% of the population, we actually don't have any great symptoms or severe symptoms.
So only 20% need to be vaccinated.
So we... Yeah, so if we can target actually this 20% for the first phases okay. where we don't have a lot of vaccine, it will be great because we could not reach the 65% for the epidemiological approach, but we could get a clinical impact. And for the quickness, I think it was very quick actually we got to that. And that was one of the thing that lots of the anti-vaxxers actually got to it and talked about it. But I have to remind everybody that why we got there simply because we had great experience and the Chinese and the Asian population got a researcher actually got a great experience with the SARS-CoV-1, the first one. And even they started before, since 2003, beginning with new approaches for to have the vaccine. So as soon as we get this infection in Wuhan, what happened in 6 days, we were able actually to have the genomes of these viruses. And in 60 days in China, actually, we were able actually to get to clinical trials. And the other thing that was really interesting that that were a recommendation actually to bring together in a lot of cases phase two and phase three. And the other thing why we can get the virus quick, the vaccine quickly, it was like an implementation or a recommendation for all companies that got to the third phase to start production, and a lot of countries put the money into it. So it's why we get almost in a year, we get for the vaccine. I think it's a big victory, not just for these companies, but for humanities to get to this kind of results in 1 year.
Now, Oksana, there's four phases of testing, I understand. If you can very quickly take me through them, but answer the question that China and Russia have approved their vaccine, some vaccines, without waiting for the phase three results. Is that a risk worth taking?
Well, so the phase three result is the largest part of the trial. It has the most amount of people in it. So phase one and two is mostly focused on smaller groups to see about whether it's safe to continue and what the dosing should look like. And then phase three, we take it into the largest population group possible, with diversity and included in that. And with the Moderna vaccine and the Pfizer vaccines, we did have over 40% of different diverse populations included, which was really important to understand how the vaccine can work in different groups. And so in this phase three trial, even when we get towards the end of it, it still may not mimic what happens in the real world. There's still things that don't translate in terms of efficacy levels, et cetera. And that's simply a statistical issue. But it does give us an understanding about overall safety. And the speed of which this has gone through is one that is world, it's a world record. But I would also like to add that, you know, these are circumstances in which the world has not, at least in modern recent times, has had to face. We look at the current, the evidence that has come up, that's a our other panelists have talked about how quickly we went from mapping the genome into those phase one trials. But there will this will be the most scrutinized data that will be published in history as well. So there's no room to hide. All eyes of the world are going to be on these 210 vaccine candidates, 47 of which are in human phases of the trial, that's phase one to three. And then we have 10 that are really at the front runners. They're a bit towards the end of the phase three trials. And we see really positive early interim results as well. So from my argument about the safety aspect is not that anything has changed from a standards perspective. Those standards remain high, and they're especially high for vaccines because we're immunizing people who are not sick. So the rigorous standards are even more so than for any other type of medical product. But what is different is that the world has screeched to a halt. All of the pharmaceutical industry, researchers, scientists have been focused on a singular problem. Other R&D development has been put on pause in order to get a vaccine. And that's what's possible. This is the speed that is possible when we really shift our focus. So in terms of whether the safety has been compromised, certainly not.
Well, Annelise, despite the unprecedented scrutiny that the research has been under that Oksana's referring to, there will be people who are nervous this is all happening too fast. I don't mean anti-vaxxers, I mean people who are just worried. How do you persuade them, Annelise, to have the jab?
I think the most important message is, we know we did not cut corners. We went as fast as we needed to be, but also as slowly as we needed to be. So the difference to the past is that, of course, there's more money involved, more resources dedicated, and that we're compressing timelines by not going sequentially, you know, phase one and phase two, then phase three, but that we are compressing the timelines by going a lot in parallel. So, for example, the policy deliberations that I'm part of already started before we had phase three trials so that we are ready for the time when the phase three results are out. So I think we are taking all the precautions that we need. It's all as pre-agreed, and we're all sticking to it. And we're doing, you know, excellent safety monitoring, but we're not cutting corners.
Azeddine, there was a survey in France yesterday. Half of French people would not want to be vaccinated against COVID-19 at the moment. How do you persuade them?
Well, that was really surprising, actually, because there is a Nature Medicine paper that came out actually in October. And the paper actually was saying that almost 71% of the world population, it was done on absolutely like 10 countries, but the most populated countries. And these countries that got the average of 71% will accept actually to take the vaccine. But it was surprising that in France is really this kind of numbers. But I think it's the people are for the first time taking their lives seriously and looking not to the expert to give them the answer, but they are weighing the risk benefits themselves. And I think it's just will take time actually educating people. I was really surprised looking at this paper because in the US it was 71% were willing actually to take the vaccine. And in France actually we were around 50%. And I think that needs us actually to engage the community is something very important. If we cannot build this trust between us scientists and between the population, explaining to them that absolutely, if we don't explain all this adverse immunization effect that we will get because we'll go to the billions of people, if we not communicate correctly with them, I think we'll not get easily to the mass vaccination. And I think that's very interesting things. Even if we get the logistics, even we get to the administration, even we get to the vaccination, if we don't get people to trust the population trust, it will be very difficult to do it.
And Oksana, in persuading people to be vaccinated, if there are unforeseen problems in a vaccine, when do those problems usually appear? Is it in these clinical testing stages, or is it in weeks, months, years further down the line?
Well, it's very common for pharmaceutical, especially new medicines, to be monitored over a period of time. So likely in this instance, anyone who's receiving a vaccine, there will be monitoring for a two-year period. In your doctors, pharmacists, they usually have a monitoring system. Here in the UK, we have the yellow card through the MHRA, which is our regulatory body, to really assess what type of problems may arise in the future. It's not possible for everything to be caught in a clinical trial. However, what we do have in terms of the history of vaccines is that the benefits far outweigh any risks. And so far in the clinical trials, the adverse effects have been really limited towards site injections, some irritation of the skin, really mild issues. However, once we do broaden to a wider population, there could be further information that is gathered. And again, this is something that will be closely monitored in every country. But if we look through the history of vaccines, really significant problems from vaccination has not been the main story here. Mostly what we've seen is that we have been able to almost eradicate polio, which the memory, the history of that, especially for many young people, can't really think about what an iron lung even looks like. So again, throughout things like also cholera, which is has been such a killer, all of these means that our life expectancy has grown and improved around the world with almost a very little or negligent amount of adverse effects. But this will be closely monitored.
Azeddine, what are some of the challenges going to be for delivering the vaccine from factory to arm, particularly somewhere like where you are yourself, Morocco, in the developing world, which doesn't have available all the resources that European or the North American countries might have?
Well, I think it's a great question, actually. Just bringing on the plane a vaccine will be a very big challenge, actually. It's why I think it was since the beginning, and I think the WHO recommendations are very great in this sense, because it will help each country, actually, to have its own strategy looking at its capacity to do it. So the logistic is very important things there. And I'm not thinking about also just Morocco, but Africa in general. I think if you have a vaccine like the Moderna one, where like the Pfizer one, where you will need actually 80 refrigerators, freezers, it's going to be tough to have this kind of vaccine in Africa. So I think it's more classical approaches for vaccines, like the one that developed by AstraZeneca or Sinopharm, will be something more appropriate for countries in Morocco. So I think it's something that each country has to have its own strategy to do it. But I think the Africans will be looking to the WHO to give them the best recommendation for that.
And also very quickly from you, Annelise, as well, the challenges of delivering this vaccine to places with really heavy, concentrated outbreaks like India, Pakistan, other developing world countries. What are those challenges?
Oh, so many challenges, because this is now, unlike a childhood vaccination program where we have the expertise, we have the track record, we have the mechanisms in place, here we are first targeting, you know, older people. So for countries that have experience in delivering influenza vaccine, they actually can, you know, to older people, they can use that experience now to roll out the COVID-19 vaccine as well. Just to let you know, so WHO developed a like a country readiness assessment tool. And so governments need to look at this. Are we ready? Do we know how to deliver? Mm-hmm. Do we know how to, you know, store this with the ultra cold chain requirement that both the first runner vaccines have? Do we have enough syringes? How do I really get to the very old? And how do I deliver to healthcare workers in hospital systems? And there's a lot of work going on. There's training modules now. Just now, I attended a simulation exercise. So countries need to go through simulation exercises now in preparedness of these first two or three or four vaccines to be approved, you know, within probably by December or early January.
All right. OK, well, unfortunately, we are out of time. There's so much more to discuss, but we'll be back on this subject many times, I'm sure. But for the moment, thanks to all our guests, Annelise Wilder-Smith, Azeddine Ibrahimi and Oksana Pizik. And thank you, too, for watching. You can see the programme again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. And for further debate, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. We are at AJ Inside Story. From me, Bernard Smith, and the entire team here, bye for now.